taken to the Isle of Patmos and left there to die. All the prisoners who were taken there are left there to die. They're on the island out there, they're not going to get anywhere. The churches, as you can see, it's almost, you can start and just make a circle through the churches. Now, there are two dominant views of these seven churches in this letter to Revelation. One view is what's called dispensationals, or dispensations of time. That each one of these churches represented a dispensation of time. The other side would be the side that I take, if you will, and that is seven churches. Now I think when you read the Bible and you interpret the Bible, you interpret it at its simplest means. And by that I mean if it says something, just simply says it, you accept that. You don't try to add to it, you don't try to make it into something spiritual that it's not. It just says what it says. That's the simplest way. And I recommend to you when you start reading the Bible and interpreting it, just take it for what it says at the beginning. Now there are things in the Bible, like chapter 4 through 22 of Revelation, that are real difficult to figure out. But there's some that just says to the church at Ephesus. I think those are seven churches that God spoke to through the Spirit, through the Apostle John, so that we would have a record and we could be challenged today by the churches from that time period. Just like 1,000 years from now, if God tarries, this church could be a church that would have a historical record that could be a challenge to the people of that day. And so in the simplest terms, I think it's just seven churches that God wrote to that he wanted to speak to and speak into. I think within those seven churches, you can find almost all the issues we find in our churches today. And I think that's the point, is it's meant to help us as we walk through this work today. Now, chapter 2 begins in verse 1 with the church of Ephesus. Let me just give you some background on Ephesus. If you go to, you don't have to go now, I'll go there real quick and read it to you. If you go to Acts chapter 18, Acts chapter 18, you'll find the first mention of Ephesus. I'll find it here to the bottom. Chapter 18, verse 19 says, when they reached Ephesus, he left them there. This is Paul's second missionary journey. Paul went on three missionary journeys. On his second missionary journey, he stopped in Ephesus. He said he left them there, meaning the people were with him. But he himself entered the synagogue and engaged in discussion with the Jews. By the way, Paul always went to the Jews first. The Jews were his people. He was a Jew. So he always, and remember when you read Romans, he said that I would give my life. He said I would give my life if it would mean my Jewish brothers would know Christ. I would put myself in hell if my brothers could go to heaven without Jesus. His point was, that doesn't work. It's an individual. Each person has to reckon with God themselves. So Paul said he went into the synagogue and engaged in discussion with the Jews. And though they asked him to stay for a longer time, he declined. But he said goodbye and stayed. And I'll come back to you again if God wills. And he set sail for Ephesus. From Ephesus. Now in chapter 19, he goes back to Ephesus. And this is on his third missionary journey. And it says in verse 10 of chapter 19, and this went on for 2 years. So he stayed in Ephesus for a couple of years now. This is also in Ephesus, which tells you a little bit about the city. If you go into chapter 19 and read it when you get home, this is where the riot took place because Demetrius, who was a silversmith, who made shrines to the idol Artemis or Diana, who was a fertility god, who they worshipped in Ephesus. And he realized when Paul started preaching and people started getting saved, what happens when people get saved? Their life changes. And instead of worshiping Artemis or Diane, the fertility god, they began to worship the true God. And they quit buying these shrines. They quit buying these little shrines made of silver. And Demetrius was losing money. Now that That's happening today, folks, in our society. I'll just give you one issue, and that's the abortion issue. Abortion is a huge, huge money-making issue in our country. When you abort a million babies a year, that's a lot of money. There's a book, if you ever want to read it, by a lady that was the director of the abortion clinic in Dallas, Texas. And the title of the book is simply Blood Money. And she said it has nothing to do with women. It has nothing to do with health. It has everything to do with how much money we can make. And when you threaten people's money, they fight back and want to destroy it. And so they had a riot before Congress. The preachers went and said, look, he's taking all our income away. Let's get rid of it. They had to be right. That all happened in Ephesus. Ephesus was a very important. You can see its location. It's right on the coast, which means it's a seaport city, which means it's a commerce city. Everything's flowing in and out of there because they have the harbor. They have two things going for them. They have commerce, and they have the goddess Diana, or the Greeks called it Artemis, and the Romans called it Diana. She was a fertility god, and they worshiped her. That was their religion. Now, I was just in Israel 6 weeks ago, and I stood at the gates of Hades. I read that this morning in chapter 1, the gates of Hades. I stood at the gates of Hades. I'll try to bring a picture of how I can show it. The gates of Hades is in Caesarea Philippi, north of Jerusalem, and it's a cave that had a temple built in front of the cave, and people would come and sacrifice animals and their children to the gods in that cave. And that cave was considered to be the entrance to the underworld. That's why it was called the Gates of Hades. And I stood there in front of that cave, and you can see where there's multiple shrines that they had built into the cave wall there. They're still there. You can still see them. And I thought, Jesus took his 12 disciples. This is another sermon. I'll give you a brief. Jesus took his 12 disciples 35 miles walking, about 35 miles walking to this Caesarea Philippi to make a point. He said, that's the gateway to hell. That's where they're sacrificing children. That's where people believe that power is. And he said, Peter, who do you say I am? Peter said, you are the Messiah. Son of the living God. Remember what Jesus said to Peter? You're right, Peter. Upon this rock, he wasn't talking about Peter, he was talking about the rock of Jesus. Upon this rock, I will build my church. And even the gates of Hades will not prevail against it. Folks, that ought to be an encouragement to you and I. We can't be beaten then. We can't be beaten. The gates of Hades will not prevail against it. That's the kind of worship that was going on in Ephesus. Same type of worship. And it was to this that these new believers, mostly Gentiles, were living the conditions they were living in. If you go a little later, that was probably around 52 AD when Paul made his first missionary journey. Then we know there's a letter in the New Testament called the Letter to the Ephesians, Ephesus. That was written about 60 AD. Paul is dealing there with this same church. He's writing to them, mostly Gentiles, saying to the Gentiles, look, you're equal to the Jews in Christ. We're all equal in Christ. He was also trying to build unity among the body. He was challenging the church in Ephesus. You've got to live differently now. You're Christians now. You're Christ followers now. You can't live like you used to live. Your life has changed. He said, you used to live in darkness. Now you live in light. Live like it. Live like you live in light. And that's the context of this church that we're talking about tonight in Ephesus. So let me read chapter 2, verses 1 through 7, and then let's go through those texts. Write to the angel of the church of Ephesus, the one who holds the seven stars in his right hand, and who walks among labor and your endurance, and that you cannot tolerate evil. You have tested those who call themselves apostles and are not, and you have found them to be liars. You also possess endurance and have tolerated many things because of my name and have not grown weary. But I have this against you. You have abandoned the love you had at first. Remember then how far you have fallen. Repent and do the works you did at first. Otherwise, I will come to you and remove your lampstand from its place, unless you repent. Yet you do have this. You hate the practices of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate. Anyone who has an ear should listen to what the Spirit says to the churches. I will give the victor the right to eat of the tree of life, which is in God's paradise. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for this word. I thank you for the church of Ephesus, for the work it did in its time, for their endurance, for their unwillingness to tolerate evil, for their willing to test those who say they are following you but are really not. Thank you for that testimony. But God, I pray that we would also hear that they left their first love. It is so easy for us to leave our first love. And in doing that, we walk away from the very thing you want us to do. So Father, help us tonight as we open these texts. Wrestle with the meaning of emphasis. And may it cause us, Father, to look deep within ourselves and allow God, through his word, to ask us the same questions and to challenge us exactly the same way he challenged the church of Ephesus. Help us to hear, Father. Help us to hear what the Spirit says to us tonight. We pray in Jesus' name. If I were to look at a calendar, if you had a calendar, I could look at every hour and every minute. What would it say about you? If I could do that, I can't. You will give your calendar, and most of us don't do a minute by minute. What would it say about you? What would it say about your priorities? What would it say about your activities? What would it say about your love? Your emphasis of your life? I've often heard it said that if you want to know a person's heart, look at their checkbook, where they spend their money, and tell you where their priorities are. To be a Christ follower, I'm going to use the word Christ follower a lot versus Christian. God, something like 85% of people in America claim to be Christian. They're not Christians. So I want to use the word Christ follower, somebody that's deliberately following Christ. So tonight and throughout, I'll say the word Christ follower. If you are a Christ follower, at the very root of your following, at the root of your obedience, at the root of your relationship, is your heart. It is a heart issue. Now everything that's in the heart ultimately comes out. That's why God uses fire. When we read in the Old Testament, fire to take the impurities out of the silver. The fire forces out what's inside. That's why we go through a lot of struggles that we go through. God puts us through struggles, not to test us, but to mature us, to rid ourselves of those impurities that destroy us so easily. Sometimes he takes things away from us, which makes us angry and hurts us, and yet in the end God is trying to purify us. Because he wants the depth of what's in us to come out. See, we can fake it for a while. I mentioned fake news this morning. We can fake it for a while. I can fake being a Christian for a while. But sooner or later, something is going to happen to tell you exactly what I believe in, what I say I believe. And I can say whatever I want, but my actions will demonstrate at some point I joke about it. I may have told you this here, but jokingly, I tell every church when they ordain something, I think I did that here. All of us stand in the pulpit like this. We all do. We all hold on to the pulpit. This is our security blanket. Can't start our tongue. We can't have time to think, whatever's in there comes out. Now, if you got time to think, you can, I'm in church, I can't say this. You don't have time to think, you'll just learn what happened. And a man that was working on my parsonage, he was soldering pipes, and he started the insulation of the box. That's pretty interesting to watch. And I was behind him, and he didn't know that. I was his pastor, I'm standing, and all of a sudden I heard what was in his heart, and it wasn't very nice. And I said, and I called his name. He went, "Ooh, I didn't know you were back there, Pastor." You know, I thought, but now I know why we're not running anybody to Christ. Now I know why we're not running anybody to Christ. Nobody wants to hear what you have to say. Because people watch us. I don't know if I told you this, or I've said it. I had a girl come to me out of the blue. I knew her for 3 years. It was the last year I was in the airport. She watched me. She said to me, this is her words, "I have watched you for the last 3 years. Can I talk to you?" 3 years we worked together every day. She said, "I've been watching you for 3 years. Now, in essence, what she said is, I've had the confidence to see that you probably are who you say you are. Can I talk to you?" And that day she came to Christ. 3 years she's watching. Because she wants to know what's really inside of her. What am I really, what really mean? You see, we can fake it for a while, but in the end, we always revert to who we are. Always. Good example of that in the New Testament, if you want to go back and look at it sometimes, the parable of the sower. Back and read the parable of the sower. Four different situations, only one of them is a true believer. Only one. The other three claimed it, but didn't live it in the end. And so Jesus calls the church at Ephesus to return to this deep love for him in order that they might reflect the gospel. It's interesting that each one of these introductions he uses a different phrase to start with. Very personal. This wasn't a letter that Aaron got last week when I sent it to all the pastors. He said, "Dear Pastor," everybody got the same letter. This is an individual letter to every church. In fact, if I have to look at the first verse of every one of these churches, you see it's a little bit different, very personal. So let's look at this letter, 1-7. Now, by the way, I want to do something different tonight. If you want to, in the middle of this thing, stop me and ask a question. Let's do that. We'll be Bible study, not just preaching. So, if you have a question, you probably won't answer it again. You won't ask it again if you leave it. And I probably may or may not have an answer. I always have an answer, I just don't know if it's right. I've got an opinion on everything. But, Cheryl, go ahead. Seriously, though, if you have a question, ask it. Somebody in here will answer it. We'll figure it out. Because you may not ask it again. So let's begin to look at this. Number one, point number one, if you will. Recovering what matters most. We have a Savior who rules the church. The church does not own itself. I, Southern Baptists, like to use the word autonomy. We are an autonomous church. That means we are not under anybody else's influence. We make our own decisions. Let me tell you, that's unbiblical. We are not an autonomous church. We are under the headship of Jesus Christ. And he calls the shots. You have an under-shepherd who works for Jesus Christ, if you will. And we submit to that. We are not autonomous. That we can disregard Jesus. He rules the church. It says, write to the angel of the church in Ephesus. The angel is the pastor. Write to the angel, the one who holds the seven stars in his right hand and who walks among the seven golden lampstands. Now that means he rules. He holds the power. You see, he has walks among the seven golden lampstands. He has the seven stars in his right hand. He is the authority. I can't tell you that enough. We will never be who God wants us to be until we really fully understand that God is in charge.
Amen.
And that Jesus doesn't ask for our cooperation. He doesn't seek our cooperation. He literally demands it. He really does. It's interesting, Brad Pitt's comment this morning that I read to you. I can't Think about it in the context of humanity. We call that arrogance. If I walked in here and said, I want you people to worship me, you would throw me out. Rightly so. But we're not talking about me. We're talking about the God who created everything. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We're talking about the one who has never failed, who has never committed sin, who will never do anything to harm us, who only lives to bring glory to himself through us. So it's not arrogance. It's not unreasonable for him to demand from us his obedience. He holds the power. He said, I walk among the seven golden lampstands. I love that. He walks among seven golden lampstands. You know what that means? The inference of that is, he's with us. He's not God. Jesus is not out there somewhere saying, manage it the best you can. And then check in with me. Literally, he is with us. Intimate. God is intimate. He wants us to be intimate with him. So he's a Savior who rules the church. Verse 2 and 3 tells us that Ephesus was a church that worked for the truth. They had good, solid teaching. Look at verse 2 and 3. He said, I know your works, your labor, your endurance, and that you can't tolerate evil. You have tested those who call themselves apostles and are not, and you have found them to be liars. You also possess endurance and have tolerated many things because of my name, and they have not grown weary. This church was a church that showed its commitment and endurance in the midst of difficult circumstances. This was not an easy time to be a believer. They had a few things working against them. One, there were a tremendous amount of Gentiles that had come to faith. And so you had a conflict between Gentile believer and Jewish believer. Remember, the Jewish had always been the children of God. And so they thought of themselves, even when they were in bondage, we read, you know, the times they were in slavery, they still always thought of themselves as better than all those around them. Because they were the chosen ones of God. And they endured that conflict. That's why in Ephesus, Jesus, in Ephesians, Paul said, no, there is no inequality. When you come to faith in Christ, you're equal. You're equal. In fact, in this room, we've got different socioeconomic groups. We've got different educational levels. We've got male and female. And you know what? At the cross, we are all guys predict somebody for me. Because some people have more to work with than others. You know what I'm talking about? Some people are a few fries short of them. You know, thing of fries. Some of us don't have the talent others have. Just think about that. You know what, if I could, you know what, I would come out in front of there with Aaron and the guys, I'd just say, nobody wants you to hear it. created in the image of God? No, nobody's ever told me that.
Do you know what it is? You said, look at me, not, we're looking at the image of God. It's pretty amazing. This church was committed to sticking to it in the most difficult times, your labors, if you work, I know your labor, your endurance. Endurance means you continue to fight, you continue to struggle. I told you before, I used to run. I'd run long distance. I'd run 6 miles, I ran 10-mile races. And I like to run, I used to, but I got old. I don't do that anymore. But it takes endurance to do that. It's easy to run a 100-yard dash. It's a bit more difficult to run a 26-mile marathon. But Christians are to be men and women of endurance, willing to face the struggle. You say you can't tolerate evil. This was a church that had at least a measure of solid doctrine, and they held to it. For you see, even with the showing of commitment and endurance, it says they rejected false teachers and false teaching that would destroy their ministry. I want you to hear that they rejected false teachers, false teaching that would destroy their ministry. In the second part of verse 2, you have tested those who call themselves apostles and are not, and you have found them to be liars. Let me tell you, church, we have an obligation to test those that are teaching and those that are speaking what they call truth from the scripture. And we have an obligation not only to test them, but to remove them if that stuff is false. If I were to stand up here tonight and teach false teaching, your pastor would come up here, and I don't doubt this in my mind at all, and say, Paul, I think you're done. I really believe in there. You would do that, wouldn't you? Yeah, I do. I would do that as a pastor. You stop. You know, I'm really off on a tangent. Pastors come and pastors go. And pastors are removed because the church doesn't like what they preach or like what they do. And I asked some guys the other day, I said, when's the last time you removed a Sunday school teacher or a deacon? You know what they said to me? It's never happened. And I said, don't you see that as a red flag? What you're saying is we've had pastors that are failing, but none of our deacons and none of our Sunday school teachers have ever failed with the Word of God. I don't buy it. You know what? One lady was honest enough to say, well, they're family members. It's kind of hard. But that was the most honest statement I ever. This church stood for doctrine. God can't bless us if we won't stand for truth. You know why we got so much junk being taught out there? It's because one of the people sitting there listening to it don't know truth themselves. And you can't identify truth if you don't know truth. And number two, we don't have the courage to confront it, even though it may be painful when it comes up. But we need to confront it. And we need to literally remove it. That's what they did. You have tested those, you have found them to be liars. That's a strong word. You have found them to be liars. And they were removed. This church had some solid things for them. Not only did they show their commitment and endurance in difficult circumstances, they rejected false teachers and false teaching, but they were motivated by the fame of Jesus. Look at the verse 3. You also possess endurance and have tolerated many things because of my name and have not run weary. Now, what they're talking about here is you tolerated the abuse. You tolerated the people attacking you. You tolerated all that comes upon those who claim Christ because of Christ, because you love me. And you're willing to put up with all that. By the way, this is coming to America. We better pull up our britches and get ready to be willing. Ray Stevens. How many of you like Ray Stevens? Anybody in here like Ray Stevens? I was thinking about this going home today. He had a song about, I don't know the whole thing. But he said he goes into a barber shop in the song, and he said, he's got long hair, and he's like, long hair, hippie guy. He goes in, and the guy said, what do you do, son? And he said, no, I just sing my songs, play my piano, and do my little shows. I looked at him and said, I'm a logger, just down from Goose Bay, Canada. Talking about was because of the people he was with.
easy to be a Christian here. Anybody can be a Christian here. It's hard to be a Christian out there.
This church, these Ephesians, they were Christians out there. Out there. They were in the suffering. But that's going to happen. But there was a problem. Next thing, first of all, but I have this against you. By the way, seven churches, five of them had it. But five of them was left. But I have this against you. You have abandoned the love that you had at first. But I have this against you. You have abandoned the love that you had at first. That's a problem. I've heard sermons about that. I've heard evangelists pray a lot of people for not evangelizing because of this church. I don't think it means that. What Jesus held against them was what they should have gotten the most. Their heart. What he's saying to them is, I want you to love me today like you loved me the day I met you. What Jesus had against them was they had abandoned their love relationship. They were doing the work. They were standing firm. They were gospeling the gospel. They were doing all the things that a church was supposed to do. But they weren't doing it anymore on the heart of God for their sake. What a tragedy. What a tragedy to do all these good things but not have love. I think we see it in what Jesus talking about, that they separated the sheep and goats. He said, some of you gave me water. Remember that text? I was thirsty, you gave me water. I was hungry, you gave me food. I didn't have clothes, you gave me shirt. They said, I'll never do it. He said, well, you did the least of these, you did it to me. And others said, but I did all this. He said, no, I don't know you. It's a hard issue. I love my wife more today than I loved her when I met her. November of 1973. See, that was, I was there, I remember. November of 73. I love her more today. I tell her every day that I love her. In fact, I tell my wife multiple times a day that I love her. She tells me multiple times a day that she loves me. We express that to each other. This church had quit loving Jesus. They were still working for Jesus, but they weren't loving him. He wants first our love, our affection. We're told in Matthew's gospel, the Pharisees came and tried to trip Jesus up by asking, what is the most important commandment? He said, love the Lord thy God with all your heart, soul, and mind. And second is likewise, love your neighbor, Jesus. Love me. Love me with all of your being. That's the Lord. We can't be effective. We can't be effective in our relationship with Christ. We don't love him. We work hard. We can diligently do things, but we don't love him. By the way, if we don't love him, we will not love others like he loves others. It's an impossibility. It's one of those things that cannot happen. So he called them into his house. You don't love me like you love me. By the way, a marriage, we have to percolate our marriage. Right? We have to do one. Some of you are going, no, I don't. You should percolate your marriage. We do this thing called date night. Now, we don't have date night. We have date afternoon because I can't stay awake that late. So we have date day. We go out in the afternoon and have our dates because it's cheaper too, and I'm fiscally conservative. Lunch meals, study. But my point is, we percolate that love relationship. We need to percolate our love relationship. You know, one way to do that, one of the simplest ways that I know to percolate love relationship, involve yourself in His Word. Just involve yourself in the Word of God. Read it. Yes, ma'am.
I have a question. You say they lost, the Word says they lost the first love. their passion for the Lord, or is it they were just plain church and not showing the love of Christ?
I think they were demonstrating walking with Christ.
Right.
That's why they endured, and they were they obviously knew the word, because they could identify those who were falsely teaching the word. So they had knowledge, they were working, says their works were good. I think it lost all their passion. Have you ever corrected someone biblically and were 100% right, but were 100% wrong because your heart was not right? I have. I was 100% right when I said, because I quoted the word God, and I was 100% wrong because my heart was cold as ice when I said it. I think he said, I want your heart to be aflame again. Passion for me. To love me. By the way, all of our other comes out of that. 5 and 6 says this. Remember then how far you have fallen up, and repent of the mercy you did at first. Otherwise, I will come to you and remove your lampstand from this place. Unless you repent, yet you do have this. You hate the practices of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate. Remember how to be faithful. Ladies and gentlemen, remember how to be faithful. How are we faithful? We must remember from whence we come, and then we repent. Twice in this, he says, you must repent. I don't see a lot of repentance going on in churches today. I don't know. I've been to a lot of church services since 1974. A lot of revivals. I've heard in 3 hours just to hear a guy preach for 3 hours home. You know, our kids, they thought vacation was going to hear preachers preach. We took vacations to go hear preachers preach. And I honestly have yet to see brokenness and repentance. Shut the place down because people were overwhelmed. They're sad. And that's sad. He said, repent. Repent. Remember how far you have fallen and repent. We won't repent until we understand where we are. That word remember, you know, the Greek has different meanings than what a lot of our English words. It's a continuous action word. When he said remember, so he's saying, continuously remember. I think in the church, a lot of times we forget who we were. We forget where we came from. We forget the walk we were walking before Jesus met us. We kind of get a little bit puffed up in ourselves about how good we are today. And we forget that we were lost. That means to turn around, to change direction. If you don't, Jesus said, I'll come back. I will come to you and I will remove your lampstand from his place and let you remember. You know what? We're told that today about 90% of churches, some Baptist churches, are in decline. I told them they're in decline. I wonder how many of those churches need to read this text and just repent. And they're coming up with a zillion reasons why we're in decline. Usually it's we don't have any young people. That's the first thing you always hear. We've got to get some young people in our church. And they look at all these external issues of why our church isn't growing. But could it be simply because we need to repent and regain our first love? Have you ever been around the new Christian? They'll drive you nuts. Man, they are just excited and happy. I come up into our church. He said, can I come back next week? I never had anybody ask me. Can I come back? I said, yeah, you come up for your own. You know what I found out about this guy? I baptized all four of them. Mom, dad, and 2 teenage kids. You know what they told me? He said, you know what we do? They grow an hour in church every week, each way. He said, you know what we do in the middle? We talk about your sermon every week. Really? And nobody's ever talked about my sermon. They spent the hour discussing the service. Man, they were on fire. Their neighbors, their neighbors.
He'll remove us before he will allow us to destroy his church. If he has to kill us, he'll kill us. If he has to end the life of that church, I believe he will. That seems harsh from a God that loves us. Remember, this is a God that's perfect. He's a God that desires that the world know him. Give you this in our language. I'll give you this. You hate the practices of the Nicolaitans and Apostolates. I did some study on that. I don't know for sure what the Nicolaitans were. But we can put them in the same category, verse 2, where it talks about those who are teaching false truth, those that are liars. This church hated them, it says. He honors them. And he said to us, we are to hate what God hates. And we are to hold fast to what God holds fast to. No matter what it means to our relationship here. He said, if you'll do this, look at verse 7 and 8. If you'll do this, anyone who has an ear should listen to what the Spirit says to the churches. I will give the victor the right feet from the tree of life, which is in God's paradise. What's a tree of life? Eternal life. What was in the garden? Adam and Eve in the garden. What couldn't they eat? They couldn't eat from the tree of life. Why? Because they would live eternally if they did. We're being told that we have eternal life. And where are we going to do it? With God in paradise. Ultimately in the New Jerusalem someday. Where there will be no tears, no sickness, no heartache. We're going to live there. 1 John 5:12 says, he who has a son has life. And he infers there is life eternal. Never ending. In closing, I'll say this. There is no, this is a statement from me. There is no place in God's economy for nominal Christians. There is no place in God's economy for nominal Christians. You are either 100% in or you are 100% out. Michael Combs was a Southern Gospel singer back in the 90s. I don't know if he's still singing or not. He had a meeting with our church. He sang a song, "There Ain't No Middle Ground." And he basically said, you're either a believer or not a believer. There isn't any middle ground. You see, if you're a believer and you start to walk away, you need to repent. You need to repent and come back. Ain't no better room. So the question before you tonight, individually, and corporately as a church, does this have any meaning to you? Could this be Jesus saying to John, write to the